What knowledge might save your life one day? Know how to spot a stroke. An easy way to remember is the acronym FAST. Face, is one side of your face droopy? Can you fully smile? Arms, can you hold your arms out straight? Speech, are you unintentionally slurring your words? Time, call an ambulance right away. Time is of the essence. Don't ever stop performing CPR on a person until the EMTs take their body away. CPR doesn't wake up a person, it's to force blood to their brain to prevent brain death so that the EMTs can revive that person. What won't kill you in Australia? The wildlife? What will kill you? Getting lost in the outback. If you're lost and out of fuel, stay with your vehicle. Move as little as possible during the day and stay in the shade. Conserve water. Rip off wing mirrors to shine at any search planes. You can drink your urine approx 1-3 times before your kidneys start to pack it in. This is absolute last resort. Don't answer the text if you are driving. If a bear comes, always run downhill, never uphill. Also, don't climb up on a tree, it will go after you. If a person asks you for something in the street, a light, the time, whatever, always keep the person in your eye line. So if they ask for the time, don't just look down at your watch. Raise your arm slightly so your watch is in sight. I was told this years ago at a self-defense thing at a corporate retreat type of event, and I wondered if it was ever going to be useful or just something to pad out the teacher's session. Then, a decade later, I was on the street late at night on my way home, and someone approached me and asked for the time. I did this, told him the time, and he just kinda stood there. Then he started asking some weird, clearly improvised, question about how he was looking for his friend's house, and he was sure it was on that street, and he had a yellow car similar to the one behind me. I didn't look back but just said yeah, yellow, and he pointed directly behind me. I said yeah, the yellow car, I saw it as I walked by, so. He paused for a second, looking like that meme of the woman with the equations around her head, then just yelled oh, fcku. And stormed off. It was only afterwards I realized that I think he wanted me to look away so he could slug me, but he wasn't prepared to attack someone that was looking right at him. If someone threatens you with a gun or something and they want to move you to another location, your chance of dying goes up considerably if you agree to relocate. Have your car keys ready in a parking lot and lock your doors immediately after getting in. If you're spinning out of control while driving, do not stare at a fixed object like a light pole or barrier. Instead, find something clear and free of debris like a ditch or field. You instinctively will steer the car wherever you are focused. 60% of the time, works every time. 911 dispatcher here. If someone is missing, overdue or otherwise isn't where they should be or not answering their phone or texts, there is absolutely no requirement to wait 24 hours to report. This is a myth perpetuated by movies and TV. While I can't tell you exactly when you should call, here are some good rules of thumb. For children under 12 years old, call as soon as you believe they are missing. Don't mess around, minutes can count with kids. If you absolutely must, you can check the obvious areas or known hiding places prior to calling. You will not get in trouble for calling 911 or emergency services even if you locate the kid before anyone is on scene. Missing children are taken very seriously and we'd rather you call early and find them before we have a chance to help than for you to call later and lower the chance of finding them. For everyone else, it depends. Again, these are some things to think about and not set in stone, so a good rule of thumb is, if you're unsure if you should call, just call. But things to think about. Are they answering their cell phone or reading, responding to texts? Do they have a serious medical condition and do you know if they have their medication? Are they suicidal or have been in the past? Are they able to care for themselves? Do they have some form of dementia or some other mental issues that cause them to be confused slash hallucinate slash etc.? Some examples. If your wife texted you 30 minutes ago saying she'll be home in 20 minutes, she has no mitigating factors, healthy, not suicidal, etc., maybe wait a little bit, even if she's not answering the phone. Phone could be dead and she decided to pick up dinner or run an errand before coming home. While I can't tell you exactly when it would be appropriate to call in this situation, use your best judgment. Even calling early in this situation, you won't get in trouble. But it likely won't be a high priority call either. Your elderly grandfather who has early stages of Alzheimer's, who is diabetic and requires regular doses of medication isn't at his home. His keys, wallet, and medication are all at home. Call immediately, don't hesitate. Those are two extremes. Contrary to common myth, you can file a missing persons report before 24 hours have passed. Putting it off a day because they went missing that night could very easily be the difference between them being found or not. A friend who grew up in a rough neighborhood taught me this one. If you're on a bus and robbers get on, you have a chance of not having your stuff taken or being bothered at all if you pretend to be asleep. For all that it's scary for the passengers when one or two fuckers with guns climb on a bus, it's also stressful for the robbers. They have to keep their eyes on a lot of people at once to prevent anyone from calling the police, prevent the driver from signaling distress somehow, and prevent all passengers from reacting in dangerous ways. If you're asleep, that's one person less for a robber to manage, so they may not bother to wake you up and have another wild card to deal with, just to get your phone and wallet. Bears can climb trees, but have trouble running down hills as they gain too much speed. If you're being chased by a bear, head for a hill rather than up a tree. Or, better yet, know the signs of a bear and have bear spray if you know, like wandering around where there are bears. If you are starving to death with no other options than foraging, you'll find food in the wild you are unsure about. Here's a method to see if it will kill you without letting it first kill you. Rub a tiny bit of what you have found on your skin, wait 2 hours for a reaction of any kind. If none, rub a bit on your lip, wait again. Eat a tiny bite, wait again. If not sick after a few hours, eat small amounts. This is only if you are out of all other options and basically how our ancestors figured out what's edible. Interestingly, edible foods tend to appear the grossest looking, hardest to obtain, reach or dangerous needles etc. while the easy, colorful ones are poisonous. Also, often the roots of plants are 10x as nutritious and plentiful, filling than what you see above ground. I am just a normal guy, no expert. Hopefully others can confirm, criticize this advice. Finally, always boil or cook things when possible. Take hot charcoals and put in, onto a log, burn out a hole, fill with water, place a heated rock in water, boom, purify Edish boiled water with nail pot. Ash won't hurt you. 100% research and verify all of these tips. A lot of information can change over time. Or don't trust Reddit strangers. If you're unsure about the movement of a tornado, put a straight object such as a tree or a street light in between you and the tornado. It'll make it way easy to see which way the tornado is moving. If the tornado appears to not be moving, it's coming right at you. Edit, usually the only reference you will have is the width. If it doesn't appear to be moving but is getting wider, it's coming towards you. At which point you want to move perpendicular to its movement. Thank you you/start_button for clearing that up. In my experience, the easiest way to check if the tornado is getting wider is using an object such as a light post. If you're in a restaurant and shit goes down, most people run for the door they came in from. If the normal exit doors are too far, crowded, you have a better chance running into the kitchen. Restaurants always have an exterior door through the kitchen, and nobody else is gonna run that way. If you're being followed, quickly try and hug someone nearby and whisper in their ear the situation quickly. Most people will just pretend to know you to keep you safe. Polar bears have insane ADHD. If one is chasing you, intermittently drop clothing items like a hat or gloves. It will stop to sniff them. Normal prey animals don't shed whole pieces of themselves. The bear will be perplexed. Saw on Reddit somewhere else. Swimming. No, seriously, if you live in a country with lots of rivers, lakes and bridges, swimming is rather important. Flammable and inflammable mean almost the same thing. Edit, not exactly the same thing. If you notice a lack of small creatures or woodlands animals nearby, most fear human interaction, but you'll know they're there. But if it is noticeably empty, then you're likely in a predator kill zone. Similarly, if you see a lot of vultures circling, it can mean dead animal or predator animal cache. So be aware of this when you're in the outdoors. Platypuses have venomous spurs on their legs. Never allow yourself to be taken to a secondary location during a kidnapping scenario. What's better, to suffer and then die in an unknown location at the hands of a person who will most likely never caught and charged, your disappearance a mystery, while also leaving your loved ones with no closure? Or to die outside, leaving plenty of DNA evidence behind, and increasing the chances of your body being found and the attacker being persecuted? Your chances of survival after being taken to a secondary location decrease dramatically. So do whatever it takes to avoid being bundled into a vehicle, or die trying.